Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Peace on earth and mercy mild, God and sinners reconciled.
Thank you for it. You may be seated. Thank you, Superintendent, for a great message tonight. Appreciate it. Dad, would you stand? We have 47 states here tonight. We have 33 nations represented tonight. And you have honored Mickey and I and the POA by making your long journeys here to be with us as we search for end time revival. But I want you to know none of this would be here if it wasn't for this great man of God right here. You may be seated. Lead and not follow. Turned 60 last week. Good looking 60, huh? You've allowed me to walk among you and preach. Was thinking, of course, my dad was old holiness preacher, and of course, we couldn't play ball. Daddy said, one day you'll get to be in all them stadiums, and I was thinking how you've honored me, and it's been the Astrodome and the Superdome and the Hoosier Dome and the Salt Palace. You've allowed me to preach among you at the general conferences and the great meetings. But I don't know when I have ever stood before you with a more desperate message than I will preach tonight. Because I believe we're at a point where we have to have a radical revival. I think we're going to have to somehow wake up the 21st century church to a first century world-changing revival. And to do that, we must lead and not follow. There is no hope until we do. And the hourglass of this dispensation is just about run out. And we don't need just another because of the times. We don't need just another meeting. We don't need just another preaching session or another great sermon. We didn't get to where we are overnight. One does not become overweight overnight. One does not grow in age overnight. And a good leader doesn't go bad all in one day's time. It's that personal spiritual deterioration in my personal life that I've been examining. Because I'm afraid of having a name that I'm alive when really I could be dead. Because even ministry can create opportunities for the enemy to work in our lives. And it's just the deceptiveness of the gradual that can happen to us. It's the cracking of a door in our personal life. It's our, when maybe in our own personal life we pitch our tent towards Sodom. And the values sort of become confused. And all of a sudden our lives has confusion in it about where God is trying to take us. I began to study not long ago the seven churches of the book of Revelation. And those are seven very powerful churches, and those letters were written to the angel of each church, and that is to the pastor. And when you study those seven churches, you will find that they began as apostolic churches. But when you study them, six of them changed. When you look at the book of Ephesus or the church at Ephesus, they left their first love. When you look at Smyrna, she said that she were Jews, but she was really of the synagogue of Satan. When you look at Thyatira, she lost her separatist position, had Jezebel teaching her Sunday school class. When you look at Pergamos, she was a worldly church sacrificing to idols. When you look at Sardis, she had her dead programs and no spirit. And God said there was only few of mine that I could find among them. And of course, when you look at Laodicea, she didn't think she needed anything. There was only one church that began that remained what it was. And the reason why it remained what it was is because there is a statement that is referred to twice when he's writing about Philadelphia. He said, because thou hast kept, everybody say kept. Because thou hast kept my word. He said, and because you have kept my word, you have remained an apostolic church that the glory of the Lord has rested upon. It can happen to a pastor. It can happen to an evangelist. It can happen to a missionary. It can happen to singers. It can happen to teachers. That's why that we've done all we've done in the last few years, and it still hadn't resulted in a first century world-changing revival church. We thought it was in our converts. We thought it was in our budgets. We thought it was in our buildings. We thought it was in our statistics. We thought it was in our Pentecostal emotional experience. We thought all that was proof that God was restoring a sick church. But boy, were we ever wrong. For our efforts and all of our human strength and ability didn't restore the patient called the church. All it did is from meeting to meeting, because of the times, stir us for us to sit up in bed, only to roll back over and go back to sleep. So I repeat that our values have become confused, and we are so comfortable in the snare of our own making that we don't really want to get out, but I'm going to tell you there's no hope for us if we don't. The apostolic movement has been known as a preaching and praying movement. And early in our history, we were a soul-winning, church-planting church. We preached and believed that in order to go to heaven, a man must be born again. And consequently, revival and evangelistic effort to reach every unsaved person and disciple them was the first priority of our church. It became the obvious agenda of our church that we must evangelize the lost. Revival meetings, many praying all night, healing revivals, camp meetings, praying conferences caught on. And it spread rapidly through the nation and around the world. And the church grew fast when revival fires burn hot. And many of our strong leaders that are among us tonight, that are now our elders, they were saved during these old-fashioned revival efforts. I asked myself the other night, I wonder what's happened to these great revival meetings. Maybe it's because I've turned 60, or maybe because I'm getting in age, but I was just wondering what's happened to our old-fashioned revival meetings. Our theology concerning heaven and hell and judgment, it leaves little choice for us to do anything less than to be total evangelistic. So tonight, we must face that there are just some things that you cannot improve upon. And that because of the times, I think that tonight with this keto message, there is a clarion, resounding clear call like that of John the Baptist to a sleeping, overweight, frustrated, tired, stressed out, burned out 21st century church. Prepare ye the way of the Lord. Make his path straight. Bring forth fruits for repentance. For the axe is laid at the root of the tree. And the fan is in his hand. And he will thoroughly, from start to finish, thoroughly, carefully, and absolutely purge his floor. And then he will baptize and rebaptize us with the Holy Ghost and with fire. There is no hope for any of us, including the man that is in the pulpit right now, until we personally and corporately lead and not follow in what the Spirit is saying to me. And what the Spirit is saying to you instead of what man is saying to us. I really enjoyed and felt the burden of our general superintendent tonight. And I enjoyed and I felt what he is speaking to this body as the leader of the United Pentecostal Church. But I don't want to just hear what God is telling Brother Bernard. I got to hear what God is saying to Anthony Mangan. And my question to you tonight is not is what Bishop is saying or what Brother Tenney is saying or what Brother Haney is saying or what Brother Bernard is saying or what Anthony Mangan is saying or what the General Board is saying or what Andy Stanley is saying or what any other preacher is saying. I'm wondering, what is God saying to you tonight? What is God saying to you? Have we placed ourselves in a position to where we can hear what the Spirit is saying to us? The man whom God wants to bless and use in this present crisis must have the courage to be different and the conviction to keep going in the right direction, come what may. Don't look to your right and don't look to your left. You only listen to the voice of God and you follow what thus saith the word of the Lord. We're not going to change things by reading our books and by agreeing with one another. We change things by prayer and fasting and by preaching the word of God and making ourselves available to God and obeying him so that he can work through us. We need to dig again the old wells, and we need to call those wells by their old name. We need people who are doers of the word and not just hear. Revival won't come by spectators sitting in the bleachers, but we're going to have to get out of the stands and get on the field and do what God has called us to do. We preach unity and continue to do our own thing, even if doing it hurts and works against others. We preach godly living and still practice compromise in our own lives. We preach love and then secretly rejoice when a brother or a sister falls. And we scream out, we want to follow the Spirit of God, yet we still fool with our petty politics of church politics. We are so tolerant of things in our lives that in our lives of others, we don't dare get too specific in our preaching anymore because it may even offend our own lives. We need revival tonight. We need a cleansing tonight. We need new love tonight. We need new unity tonight. We need a baptism of Holy Ghost power in our lives tonight. We need a revival that deals with causes and not symptoms. We start dealing with the symptoms. We need to start dealing with the causes. We need a radical revival. Tonight, we don't need some little seed surgeon to come in and clip and prune our limbs. We need a radical revival that goes all the way to our roots tonight. We don't need some little feel-good message. We need something that shakes us of our foundation to realize that the Lord is getting ready to come. And our bishop spoke to us tonight. God, through history, he's always had a people in dark days. You don't have to worry about God's with you and God's with me. And God is with us. Just as he used Joseph and Daniel and Esther and Mordecai and Nehemiah and Ezra and Zerubbabel and Moses and Elijah. And we got Dr. Hart here tomorrow to deal with our stress, but Elijah was a pretty stressed out guy. He got under a tree and wanted to die. He was so messed up. But God took Elijah and Elisha and all the apostles. And when God gave them answers in their time of crisis, when no other answer could be found, and you're here with your frustration, and we're here with our church problems, and we're here with people that's turned their back on us, and we're here frustrated and bruised and hurt. But I'm here to tell you, you're not by yourself. God has sent to this place a heavenly host of angels that when we walk out of here next Thursday night, there will be a new walk, there will be a new step. Now is our time. Now is our time to lead and not follow. Don't you look right or left. You go straight forward. You keep moving in the Holy Ghost. It doesn't matter how many papers we shuffle. It doesn't matter how many commissions we put together as a general board. It doesn't matter how many committees you form or how many four-color publications that we put out. It matters not how many conferences we have. It matters not how many seminars we give, our high educational achievements, which I thank God we're doing. It matters not where we go, even media-wise. It matters not how many you have on your staff. It matters not how many is on your church roll. None of that means anything unless we have a first century revival that can shake a 21st century church. We got to wake up this church that's increased with good. You let me tell you off, we're better off than we've ever been. We're more blessed than we've ever been. We preachers are living in houses that we thought we'd never live in. We're driving the finest automobiles that there are to drive. We wear the finest suit of clothes that we can wear. We need an apostolic revival that can take us to the core value of what all of this is about. Tell you what's happened to us. We're locked up inside our four doors. Thank you, Brother Superintendent. Thank you for telling us we're locked up inside our four doors. We've got our Pentecostal catechisms down pat, and the Lord's back side of this church a knocking. He's saying, if anybody on the other side of that closed door, if you will hear what I'm trying to say to you, I will come into you. I will come into you, preacher. I will come into you, pastor. I will come into you, father and mother. I will come in and sup with you and with your church. I will fellowship with you. I will bless you. I will revive you. I will grant to you to sit with my throne. I will give you power to rule and to reign with me. You can't beat that kind of opportunity. God is sort of tired of us being satisfied with a mere visitation that stirs us up for a little while. And we leave because of the times, or we leave general conference and we're stirred. Then 4 or 5 weeks later, we're back to the same old mundane and routine. God is interested in a habitation and permanently changing preachers and preachers' wives and churches and homes and families and individual lives. These are difficult times, but in difficult times, God produces heroes. He doesn't produce cowards. And it's time you make up your mind whether you're going to be one of God's heroes or whether you're going to be a coward. You got to make up your mind whether you're going to be a revivalist. There is a statement that's been driving me since the first of the year. The Bible says there was a nobleman that went into a far country to receive for himself a kingdom and to return. And he called his servants and he said, occupy till I come. And if you don't believe that one little statement, occupy till I come, unless you believe that, you don't have a gospel. You only have a symbol. You don't have a savior. You have a tomb, but you don't have a triumph. You've got a philosophy, but you have no power of God unto salvation. I tell you tonight, if we do have a living Christ, which I believe we do, but if we do have a living Christ, then we do have a returning Christ. And he said, if I am coming back, then I want my church to occupy until I get there. He said, occupy. He said, I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. He said, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. He said, go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. He said, but ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you. And ye shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and the uttermost parts of the earth. This gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness, and then shall the end come. We are the generation upon whom the ends of the world are come. And there is not one paragraph in this Bible that is reserved for failure with the gospel of Jesus Christ. We are predicated on victory. We are built on victory. And his return is just as certain as his Bethlehem birth. And he has great plans for these end times. And heaven is not about to go default, and neither am I. Mark says, at the beginning of the church age in the first century, he said, and they went forth. And they preached everywhere, and the Lord working with them and confirming the word with signs following. Amen. Mark says the same condition that prevailed at the beginning of the church age is promised at the end of the church age. So we have a first century world-changing revival church. Can we have that in the 21st century? We can have that if we practice what they practice, and that is the preaching of the word with the Lord confirming it with signs following. It's prayer. It's fasting. That's what brings about revival, is prayer and fasting. We got to get back on our knees. Somebody needs to preach a good old message on prayer for us. We like 2 Chronicles 7:14, but we sometimes forget 13. We blame everything on the devil. But God said, let me tell you something. If I close up the heavens, if I let the locusts destroy everything, he's not blaming it on the devil. He said, if I do that to you, you still have an out. If you think you're in a burnover field, if you're ready to throw your hands up and quit, if it looks like revival is locked up in your church, he said, even if I did it, you can move me. If my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face. He said, you do four things. He said, you pray, you humble yourself, you seek my face, you turn from your wicked ways. God said, you do four things, then I will do three things. I will forgive you. I will heal your land. I will heal your marriage. I will heal your body. I will renew your spirit. There's nothing like old-fashioned prayer. It'll still bring apostolic revival to any church. Prayer. I want you to notice something Paul said. He said, for the mystery of iniquity, it's already at work. He said, only he who hindereth will hinder until he, that's the Holy Ghost, the hinder until he be taken out of the way, until the rapture of the Holy Ghost church. We have militant power. Our lives, our churches, our homes, our cities, our communities. We got Holy Ghost power. Our bishop preached to us already. We got Holy Ghost power. The Holy Ghost ought to be operating in our churches. Well, it's gotten real quiet here. Maybe that's our problem. The only thing that's holding the devil back is Holy Ghost. He knows his time is short. But Paul is telling us there isn't room in this earth for both the Antichrist and a Holy Ghost filled church. He said, so until that Holy Ghost is taken out of the way, that man can't be revealed. You let me tell you what I'm going after. You let me tell you what the POA is striving for in 2010. I'm going after an apostolic move of the Holy Ghost in this congregation. Now you do it any way you want to do it. You have church any way you want to have church. That's your business, because I'm going to talk about that in a minute. We need to leave one another alone. And if somebody wants to have church the way they want to have church, they can have church. But as for me, I want an apostolic Holy Ghost, Ark of the Covenant, moving in my life. I believe in tongues is the sign of the Holy Ghost. But I do not believe that tongues is the Holy Ghost. And just because people cha-cha-ta-ta-ta a little bit doesn't mean a lot of things are going on. We need more than just cha-cha-ta-ta. We got to have the power and the operation and the anointing of the Holy Ghost in our churches. So desperately hungry for God. I wouldn't dare. Now I'm going to upset some of you. General Board, please don't be upset with me, but I just got to say something. Our missionaries and our evangelists, they're so frustrated. They may not talk to you. I'm very confidential. They know I won't tell it. Only to 3,000 people. They said our churches are deader than they've ever been. Our evangelist said they can't only get our churches alive. It's a shame if we're apostolic to have dead churches. It's bad enough to be a denominational church and be dead, but if you call yourself Pentecostal and it's dead, that's bad. We better get back to where the gifts of the Spirit operate in our church. We need tongues and interpretation. We need prophecy. Words. What are you saying, God? I don't know. I don't want nothing else. We've got our plans. We've got our lights and we have our creative teams and I like that. But God, I want to hear what you're saying. I don't want to come to church and go home the way I came. I don't want to come to church and put the little yellow envelope in the plate and say I've been to church. When our people come to church, it ought to be a place to not come to. It ought to be a place to go from. They ought to be so on fire that they take it into the cities. We turn our restaurants upside down. Our supermarkets upside down. We got to have a Holy Ghost revival. We become like Saul. The old time that Saul was king, he never inquired where the ark was. He just went on having church. Ooh, thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise Jesus. Thank you, God. You are holy. Oh, so holy. Can't nobody move me like Jesus. No ark. Saul just kept on having church. But the first thing David did when he became king is, where's the Ark of the Covenant? Where's the power? Where's the anointing? Where's the Holy Ghost? Where's the inspiration? Where's the ark? I want the ark. Well, the Philistines had it. Philistines couldn't keep it very long because all their gods were falling over in front of it. So they put it on a new cart and David went and got it. And there's something that troubles me about that story. Because when they're bringing that ark back to Israel where it belongs, an ox stumbles and Uzzah reaches out and touches it and he falls dead. And that's sort of confusing because they're taking it to where God wanted it. They're taking it to where God wanted it. And they're having a worship service while they're going there. But the problem is, David saw how the Philistines carried it. And the Philistines built a new ark. So David saw how convenient and easy it was to carry the ark. So the Bible said David built a new ark. I'm going to tell you, even if you're taking God from where he was to where he wants to be, you better do it his way. That goes for all of us. We better not have our Pentecostal traditions. If we're going to take it in our worship, we better give God everything we got. See, they were on a cart. David, you knew better than that. Only the Levites could touch that thing. Then it got a little further than that. He said, you can only carry it on your shoulders. And then he took it a little further than that. He said, you can't just let a Levite take it. It's got to be a consecrated Levite. He said, and then you put it on the shoulders. Even if you have it going to where I want it to go, I don't want it on a cart. You can't take the spiritual and mix it with the secular. There is only one way to have revival. That is the Holy Ghost. Tonight, we got to get it off of carts. We got to get this thing on our shoulders. It's prayer. It's fasting. It's loving God. It's seeking the face of God. It's following after God. It's easy to get your cart and just pull along, shout a little bit, but somebody may die. You better get it back on your shoulders. If you got to sweat a little bit, it's okay. But get the ark on your shoulders so we can get God where he needs to be. We can't take the anointed things of God and put it in the fleshly hands of man. God never intended for his glory to ride in a cart. He intended his glory to be carried on the shoulders of the priest. Get the cart, get the ark off of the cart, and get the ark on your shoulders. Because everything went good. Well, things are going good. It went good for a while. They were doing real good, just moving along. All of a sudden, the ox stumbled. Uzzah was doing God a favor. He didn't want this thing to fall off of the cart. So he just tried to steady it. And when he did and he touched it, the Bible said he dropped dead. When you read that, it really moved me. Because the place where it stumbled wasn't in the road. But the writer made sure we understood it stumbled on the threshing floor, which is where spiritual sacrifice and spiritual blessing had been offered up. Uzzah was killed on the threshing floor, not just down the road somewhere, at the threshing floor. Revival is going to come when we get the ark off of the cart and get it on our shoulders. And I am desperately in hunger for an apostolic move of God, and I'm not going to stop until I have it. Does anybody believe that? Is anybody hungry for the Holy Ghost? Is anybody desperate for God? You know, what they used to tell us in old time, those old time revivals I'm talking about. I'm talking about you, Bishop. I don't know how long since it's been since you talked in tongues. How long has it been?
A few minutes.
Oh, just a few minutes. Okay. But what they used to tell us is, my daddy would come in on Sunday night, Billy. If that church was dead, he'd say, "Why'd you come here? Hear me preach? I didn't come here to tickle your ears. Lane, get an accordion." That's what we had back then when I was 7, 8 years old. Mother'd get an accordion. Daddy'd get a tambourine. Mother'd take one aisle and daddy'd take the other. Well, I don't know how deep that is. Well, that's our problem. We've gotten so deep that we're missing the depths of the Holy Ghost. And if that didn't work, daddy'd call the elders up. He'd say, "Six over here, six over here. Nobody's to walk out that door. I'm praying for everybody in this room before you leave." And that's when we had 500 or 600 people. My daddy would stand there as a young man. They'd come through. He held them till they talked in tongues. If they didn't talk in tongues, he shoved them down until they did talk in tongues. You talked in tongues in self-defense. But I tell you what we had. When we came to church, deaf ears were unstopped. Blind eyes were unstopped. People's lives were changed. Your daddy had it. People ran down the aisle saying, "I want God. I want God. I want God." I'm going to tell you, stay in just a minute. I'm not through. I'm going to finish. Where's Priscilla Magruder? She's here. Not even supposed to be here. Come here, Priscilla. They don't think she's going to live that long. We need to take care of that right now. She's not even supposed to be here. This isn't in my message, but why don't we get a little apostolic right now? Come on, men. What y'all waiting on? I mean, somebody ought to be running down here. I believe God can smite this cancer right now in the name of Jesus. Sung in our churches. In the name of Jesus, I command every malignant cell to die. On the authority of the Word of God, die! Priscilla, go ahead, Carol, claim it in Jesus' name. Why don't a cancer cell die right now? We're apostolic. Well, we'll be able to call that thing out in Jesus' name. You may be seated. Thank you, men. We smite that thing. You tumor, you swivel up in the name of Jesus. Every malignant cell die in Jesus' name. Anybody believe that tonight? My grandfather, 50-something years ago, Sister Carol was in a hospital in Beaumont, Texas. He walked in there with his bottle of oil, and the doctor said she wouldn't live through the night. My old grandfather grabbed that bottle of oil. He said, "Death, I'm here. And there's not enough room in this room for me and you both. And I just want you to know I'm not leaving so you can get out of here." She lived 50 more years, and she moved here and died just a few years ago. At 80-something years of age, we need to look at the devil and say, "Devil, I'm here. There's no room for both of us in this room. There's no room for both of us in this church. Devil, I'm here." Devil, I came here tired. Devil, I came here burned out. And Dr. Hart's going to help me work smarter. He's going to help you work smarter tomorrow. And we're going to be better because of him and God. But I want the devil to know something tonight. Whether I get Dr. Hart or Dr. G.A. or Dr. Bernard or Dr. Mangan, I want the devil to know something. If I'm tired, burned out, stressed out, I'm going under swinging. There's no room for me and him in the same room. I put my foot on a rock, and there ain't no devil in hell that can come against me. For the gates of hell shall not prevail against the church. Devil, I'm not leaving. We've had people walk out of our church, but devil, I'm not leaving. They've had close people walk out of their church and hurt deeply, but devil, we're not leaving. You just might as well get your mind made up. I've got my foot on the rock, and there's no devil and demon in hell. I'm hanging on to the Ark of the Covenant. I've got the Ark operating in my life. No devil. Word of a conqueror, like Paul on the ship. I told God this afternoon, Paul said, boys, not looking too hot here. Went a pretty big storm, and the storms are raging. I can't even promise you that the boat's going to stay in pieces. But there's one thing I can tell you. If this thing gets knocked apart, you just grab on to a 2x4. Because last night there stood by me an angel of God, of whose I am and whom I serve. And he let me know that I may have to get there with just a 2x4, but I'm going to get there. So devil, I want you to know something tonight. The ship may be battered. Our lives may be torn. There may be things coming against our family. But devil, let me tell you something. I got a hold of a board. I want you to know, you old Antichrist, dirty, filthy, nasty spirit that's been assaulting our churches and been assaulting our families and been assaulting our children and been assaulting our home, been assaulting our ministers and family. Mr. Antichrist, there's not room in this world for me and you. And I'm not leaving here until God wants me to leave. So you better know, Mr. Devil, you're in for a fight. And I've got my hands raised. I've got my mind made up. Devil, you're in for a fight. Somebody needs a shout. There stood by me this night an angel of God, of whose I am and whom I serve. And devil, I'm not leaving. I've got my mind made up. Like that man walked past that little boy. They were playing that baseball game. You've heard the story. He said, son, who's winning? He said, they are. He said, what's the score? He said, it's 185-0. He said, wow, that's bad. He said, don't worry, sir. He said, we hadn't come to bat yet. I want you to know the one that's got a hold of this bat. He said, I'm Alpha and Omega. I'm the beginning and the end. I'm the first and the last. And beside me, there is no other. The score may not look good right now. There may be something that came against you right now. But I've just now come to bat. And when you read the last chapter of the living word, everything is going to be all right. Don't you think about giving up. Don't you think about giving in. Dr. Hart, tell us how to get better tomorrow. Tell me how to take a Sabbath. I need to know that. Help me best. I got too much Vaseline in me. That's my mother. I need somebody to get that DNA out of me. But I'm going to tell you, when you think we've gone through something and we start talking about our burnout and all the stuff we're in, Hebrews 12 says we are compassed by a great cloud of witnesses. And when you have some saint leave you that gives you an ulcer, or when a church board member rises up against you, or you have people walk out and you think it's going to kill us, and it does, and I've suffered and I've hurt myself, just look up at that cloud. There's a man up there by the name of Paul who said, thrice I was beaten and thrice I was in shipwreck. He had his head cut off. Look up there. There's a Simon Peter that was crucified upside down. Look up there. There's John the Beloved who was placed on the Isle of Patmos in ball and all. Look up there. Every apostle was a martyr except one. And they're screaming back at POA and BOTT. Come on, you can make it. Don't let nothing get you down. They're cheering for you. They're believing in you. They're screaming at you. You can make it. You can make it. You can. Just look up. Come on. Come on, Anthony. Don't let that get you down. Don't let that steal your revival. I came through shipwreck. I came through back being beaten. I had my head cut off. But come on, you can make it. You can make it. People's cut our hearts out. We've watched our hearts, kids we've dedicated, and watched them cut our hearts out and lay it there. Dr. Hart will tell you, I saw it on the DVD that he did when he spoke at the South Cal conference. He said the three most stressful jobs in America is number one, preacher's wife. Number two, the preacher. Number three, the president of the United States of America. Yes, we have stress. And yes, it's a pumping. But let me tell you, I got a God that has come to meet us at BOTT. That if I can get this back on my shoulder and I can learn to work a little smarter and I can learn to take a Sabbath that God told me to take, and if I can start being like Jesus and take myself to the mountain and rest some, we're going to get to feeling like doing it again. There are no small churches. There are no big churches. When you look at Revelation, he's walking in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks. He didn't have a Sunday school board up there telling you which one was the biggest. He wasn't telling you which one was having the greatest revival. He just said, I'm in them all. There are no strongholds or deadlocks that he can't break. He can handle anything that's in your church or in your family. There are no mountains he can't climb. There are no rivers that he can't cross over. If you've read Genesis 1 and 1 and finished with the last chapter of Revelation, you let me tell you, everything's going to be all right. And I say to you what God said to Abraham, is there anything too hard for the Lord? And I say to you, as the angel said to Moses, with God all things are possible. And I say to you what Jesus said to his disciples when they came to him and said, how can these certain people enter the kingdom of God? Jesus looked back at his apostles. He said, with men this is impossible, but with God all things are possible. Well, what's our answer? I'm going to give you our answer. Number one, we're going to work smarter and get our health back. Then number two, we're going to get to doing what we've been doing. We're going to preach Holy Ghost and talking in tongues. We're going to preach a sanctification of a lifestyle. And we're going to preach the soon coming of the Lord. Gentlemen, church, when's the last time you've heard some preacher really preach on the coming of the Lord? My daddy used to preach it every other week. I mean, we walked around on our tiptoes. We had rapture practice. Well, it didn't happen. That was 50 years ago. Well, we're 50 years closer. If he felt it then, we sure ought to be preaching it now. We've let 88 Reasons, we've let Y2K, we've let all these prophecy books that said he is coming in 19 this and 19 that get us away from preaching from the coming of the Lord. We got to get back to where we start preaching the rapture. We got to get back to where we preach. If we've got to live in Christ, we've got to return in Christ. We've got to get back to preaching the soon coming of Jesus. Martin Luther said, there's only 2 days on my calendar, this day and that day. And we ought to live life as if there's only 2 days on our calendar, this day and that day. Let me tell you what's going to bring revival. Let's go home next Sunday and let's start preaching on the second coming of the Lord. Let's start preaching on a rapture. Maybe I'm just outdated. Maybe I'm too old. Maybe I've lost it. But I still believe Jesus is coming. C.S. Lewis said, if you read history, you will find Christians who did the most for the present world were precisely those that thought more of the next world. And because now we think so little of the next world, we have become very ineffective in this world because we've quit preaching about heaven and because we quit preaching about the coming of the Lord. I want to tell you what to bring revival back to our churches. Get to preaching the coming of Jesus Christ. I'm going to tell you what else to bring revival to our church. And I know I'm dating myself. And the younger preachers that's on the program, you can get up here and straighten me out. But I'm going to tell you, we're missing the eschatological doctrines of the Bible. We're not preaching about heaven. We're not preaching about eternity. And I can't even name the last time that I've even preached about hell. Can you? He came to save us from hell. Now I know what we're going through. This isn't a cuss word, so don't put this on YouTube. But our people are living in so much hell that every time they come to church, we spend all of our time lifting them up and building their faith, and we need to. But the bottom line is there is a hell, and there is a lake of fire, and we got to spare mankind from it. There is a judgment. There is a judgment where we're going to stand before God. And I'm afraid that why some of our churches are not having revival is we've quit preaching the coming of the Lord. We've quit preaching about heaven. We've quit preaching about judgment. We've quit preaching about hell. And we've quit preaching about eternity. If we can get those five things, and I'm not talking about every time you get up, but I'm talking about throwing that in occasionally in your sermon repertoire. I'm talking about bringing revival back to our churches. I'm talking about getting our people believing in what God kept our eyes upon. I believe that it will bring a revival along with the Ark of the Covenant. I believe it will bring a revival back to our church because faith cometh by hearing and hearing by the Word of God. Then the last thing is, whatever happened to old-fashioned repentance preaching? We hear good messages on God's love and His blessings and His precepts for coping with life. We hear messages on loving others and serving others and being a kind person. All of that is scriptures. But whatever happened to repentance preaching? Repentance is the message of John the Baptist. Repentance was the message of Jesus Christ. And repentance was the message of the apostles, and particularly the apostle Peter. God doesn't suggest such action. He requires it. God now commandeth all men everywhere to repent, because he hath appointed a day in which he will judge the world in righteousness. That will be the last day. And Jesus Christ tells us he came for that very purpose, to cause sinners to repentance. As I close, I will get very practical.
before I close tonight. What must you and I do to have revival that we most desperately need? We need to repent for our sins. And when we are a group of holiness people, most of our sin questions are on things that we do or where we go or how we dress. So long as we don't go or do or dress wrong, we're not sinners. But when you study the Word of God, He speaks more about the sins of omission than He does about the sins of commission. And He said, the man that knoweth to do good and doeth it not, to him it is sin. So dress it up the best you want to dress it up. Look as nice as you want to nice it. Dress everybody down that doesn't dress like you do. And when you get it all said and done, if you're not doing what I preach from the Word of God tonight, you're sinning. Repent means we got to get honest. Repent means we've got to get transparent. We've got to get honest before God about our sins, our personal sins. It means despising our sins. It means confessing our sins. It means turning from our sins. It means taking steps to see that we don't repeat those sins again. We need a confession, repentant servants before God tonight. This whole congregation needs to repent. And my general superintendent, you can rebuke me when it's over, but I'm going to take it for right now. Dress me when it's done. But there is nobody on this platform that doesn't need to repent. And there's nobody in this congregation that doesn't need to repent. There is no office that you hold that keeps you from repenting. There is no church that you pastor that keeps you from repenting. We got to repent and get humble before God. We need to confess. We need to confess of our critical attitudes. I'm praying for you. I don't know if Jesus could be the superintendent of our organization. We're so critical of so many things. We're so competitive. When is God going to break us of our competitive of how many you have? How many, who cares what how many has? There's giftings in the work of God. Some guy may be having 100 and doing more than you with 2,000 because he's given God everything he got. Let's get rid of our competitive spirits. And if God doesn't clean us of jealousy among us, God needs to watch us of jealousy. There's so much junk inside of us. We got it all fixed on the outside, but brother, on the inside, there's jealousy inside of us. We got a 3-inch tongue that can slay a 6-foot man. We'll run our traps in our mouth about a man of God. We need old-fashioned repentance. We need a revival. We need something to get down inside our soul. We need to come before God with broken hearts and get rid of our big heads. We need to confess our sins instead of bragging about our statistics. We need to reach for our brother. We need to reach for those that may be confused in where they are in their walk with God. It's easy to watch Facebook and Twitter. I would hate to know that I talked about that man or woman before I picked up the phone and called them.
Somebody said, well, he's moving on this and moving on that. And they may be. If they do, then why don't you pick up the Bible says if some brother's offended you, go to him. Let me take a little deeper than that. He said, go alone. He didn't say call the superintendent. No, he said, go to him alone. He said, then if he don't respond, take an elder. God, help us spare everybody we can spare. Help us. Repent. Turn. Reach. Remember. Remember we are in the book before the coming of the Lord. And the book of Jude is right before the book of Revelation. When God allowed the translators, as I close, to put it all together, he didn't let Jude come behind Corinthians. He didn't let Jude be placed behind Romans. He put Jude right before Revelation. And he gave us those three powerful verses at the beginning of Jude that we all learn and know. Earnestly contend for the faith that was once delivered to the saints. And we've got to earnestly contend for the faith that was once delivered to the saints. But the book of Jude doesn't end with verse 3. There is a verse 20. But ye beloved, building up yourself on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost, keep yourself in the love of God, looking for the mercy of the Lord Jesus Christ unto your eternal life. Brother Mullins, I've been looking for the mercy of the Lord. I've been asking God for his mercy on Anthony and Mickey Mangan. I've been pleading. I've got 1, 2, and 3 of you down. I'm going to earnestly contend for our doctrinal belief. I am going to stay there, but there is more to Jude. There's a verse 22. And some having compassion making a difference. And some having compassion making a difference. And others, there is a verse 23. And others having fear pulling them out of the fire, hating even the garment spotted by the flesh. This afternoon when I was alone with God, my times of prayer, I said, God, we get so distracted. And there's things that just distract us and gets me pulled away from the POA. I thank God for the UPC. I thank God for my leaders. And I thank God for these great men of God. But virtually, it's not the UPC that God's called me to. God's called me to the POA. And what I got to do is keep this congregation earnestly contending for the faith that was once delivered to the saint. And what I got to do is to make sure I got a church that doesn't get distracted by the cares of this life, but they're constantly pulling people out of the lake of fire. And you would have thought you and I would have compared notes tonight, but I'm ending with what has gotten on this man, our pastor along with me. Matthew 25 has been our theme. I'm going to tell you, I'm going after lost souls. I am committed to go after lost souls with everything that is within me. And now maybe I've done messed myself up with some of you, so I might as well go ahead and finish it off. I'm going to tell you, in our tongue lashing, we need to keep our tongues off of one another on how we reach the world. There are some that go in weekends and they have hundreds get the Holy Ghost, and we start criticizing them. And then there's the others that they like to do it one Bible study at a time. They like to have house churches, and they're doing it and discipling people as they go. Let me tell you, both of them is right. And why, when somebody doesn't reach the world the way you want it to be done, why do we have to criticize the way they do it? Why can't we just say, if he wants to reach the world that way, do it. If he wants to reach the world that way, do it. Let's just reach the world. Let's just reach the world. So we've decided, you may be seated. We've decided in Alexandria we're going to the streets. Now, there ain't too many streets to go to in Alexandria. We don't have but 45,000 people, but we're going to the streets. Come here, Brian, just a minute. God bless Brian, and God bless Brian tremendously, and he'll get upset with me about this. Come here, Bonnie and Marshall. But he caught this burden of what I wanted to do. And so this Thanksgiving and this Christmas, we call. We got John Russell. Where's John? Is he in here tonight? John Russell, where are you? Prayer room, okay. John Russell got a hold of all of the other denominations down in the projects. Among our, there you are, John. John was Mr. Louisiana, Denny. In 1986, he played for Airline High School. He was Mr. Basketball for the state of Louisiana. He went to college and played for Tim Floyd, signed with the Portland Trailblazers, and snorted his contract up his nose with cocaine. Ended up homeless in Alexandria. He got saved through our Grace House, and now he's pastoring our daughter work down in the projects. But Brian and Mike Grant, they got the money to do it, so he went. We got the Baptists and the Methodist pastors. We told them to get all their people together. Leave it right there just a minute. We told them to get all their people together that was hungry and that didn't have dinners. We wasn't just going to feed the sinners. We was going to feed other denominations. We're going to let them know what the apostolics do. He got all those preachers together. We barbecued chicken. Go ahead, keep it going. Pastor Terry was bagging them. Look at him. He was bagging them on Thanksgiving. I was bagging them. We worked through Thanksgiving and Christmas, and we had apostolic revival. I told Brian, I said, we need a baptistry. So Brian said, okay, let's build one. So there he built us a baptistry. It's got a men and women's changing room in it. It's got a generator that runs it. We take that when we have tent meetings and when we have block parties. But they came along. They said, we can't wait to have block parties. Every Saturday morning at 10 o'clock, we're going to go to the streets and we're going to have revival. So we go back to Brian. We say, Brian, we need a much smaller trailer that we can just hook up. So he had one built. You can't get that trailer anywhere else. That is a custom-built horse trailer baptizing tank. And every Saturday morning at 10 a.m., every Saturday morning. Two Saturdays ago, it was 27 degrees. He called me, said, you think we ought to go try to baptize or not? I said, we better not do it today. It's a little too cold. But every Saturday, we're going to the streets. We may baptize one or we may baptize 10. But there's one thing we're going to do. We're getting ready to carry this gospel to every corner we can carry it to. So I'd go to conferences and I'd hear all y'all preach. You may be seated. I'd hear everybody preaching about having a multicultural church. This is one of my dear friends, and there's another one of my dear friends, and we talk weekly, and I'd call Randy and he'd talk about this Asian getting the Holy Ghost, or we got this Thai service going. We got all these Hispanics coming. Well, multicultural in Alexandria is Caucasians, African Americans, rednecks, and Cajuns. I mean, when you get Cajuns and rednecks, that was our multicultural church until they came along. All of a sudden, we ought to have revival. They said, Pastor, we found some Burmese people. Bring them out. Would you do that? So about 6 months ago, we started a Burmese church. We baptized over 30 in the name of Jesus. These are our people from Burmese. This is in Alexandria. This is our church. This is what you preached about. This is our church. 6 months ago, these people wasn't here. They're from China. They're from Vietnam. They're from Burmese. I'm proud of our church. There's the new POA. He texted me Sunday. He said, Pastor, he said, you won't believe what happened. I just got back from a little community out here. He said, and I found some people from India this Saturday. Bring them out. Their first time in a Pentecostal church was Sunday morning. They know nothing about Pentecostals. They've only been in this sanctuary one time. But we now got them in a Bible study this week. They're from India. Look at our church to be from India. We're going to pull them out of hell. We're going to reach for souls. We're going to have apostolic revival. These people have to be scared slap dab to death. Because Sunday morning they came to church and they were on the second bench. And we had a Holy Ghost explosion. You know what that is? No preaching. I mean, people were in the aisles. People were out in the spirit. People were drunk on the Holy Ghost. And they saw that. This is on their second time in this building. But they're in a Bible study. And the next time you see them, there's going to be a great, great thing that's happening to them. Mark and Ginger, where are you? Where's Mark and Ginger Cross? I'm going to really get criticized for this, but go ahead. Maybe since I preach, you won't do it. Mark was one of our nurses. He wasn't one of ours then. He was a nurse. Wasn't in the church. And he got hooked on drugs. And he started stealing drugs from Cabrini Hospital. And they caught him and fired him. And he went to rehab and started coming to church. God filled him with the Holy Ghost. We baptized him in the name of Jesus. He became a great servant here. 2 years ago in our 21-day fast, Mickey got burdened because our family had been touched by chemicals in our family. And alcohol had gripped our family with other addictions. And Mickey said, we're going to start a program in this church for those that are addicted. So we started our 7 program. We incorporated the 12 steps. We incorporated Celebrate Recovery. And we dosed it with a good dose of the Holy Ghost. And now we got people coming on our campus every Wednesday night and every Saturday night that are not members of our church yet, but they're coming here to celebrate recovery. And we're going to be able to talk to them about the baptism of the Holy Ghost and their lives being changed. There's so many pulling them out of the fire. You can criticize me if you want to, but I'm going to do everything I can do to reach a lost and dying man. This is really going to get hairy, and this is where I'm going to really sever some of you. But I've reached a point where at the POA, we're talking about building his kingdom. And I got to search in my heart at sacrifice. And I'm really wondering, whose kingdom am I building? Am I building his kingdom or am I building my kingdom? So I got to evaluating why we had such great growth. And then, bam, we hit a little spot and I realized what happened. In just a matter of 6 months to a year, 4 of our greatest Bible study teachers, they came to me and said, God called them to preach. Dennis and Mary, would you come up here? They were discipling people. And they said, Pastor, we feel like that God's hand's upon us. I said, okay, stand still and see the salvation of the Lord. And God got a hold of them. And they started preaching. Then God called them to pastor. Now there's their church right there. Come in, Danzies. The Danzies came here. They were good Sunday school teachers. They caught the vision of what God wanted to do. I really wish these people wouldn't have left. I think we'd done been over 3,000 if I could have kept these 4 people with us, because they were disciplers, they were Bible study teachers, and they held up the hands of their pastors. But they said, God's got a work for us to do. It wasn't long after that he got elected a little church in Baton Rouge. And there it is on the screen. And there's the inside of their church in Baton Rouge. He called me the other day. He said, Pastor, we're going to start a daughter work in Lavanya. which is a little town outside of Baton Rouge, between Croc Springs and Baton Rouge. They've now started a daughter work there. What are you doing, Pastor? POA, we may be going down. We're going to go up because God's going to honor it. But I tell you what, I'm getting ready to send people out. And I'm going to see them go the highways and the byways. Come here, Lamar. Come on, Steph, you come up here with me. Lamar, let me tell you about this guy. You got a minute? Let me tell you about it. His mother and daddy's in this church. This guy was so bad when he was a teenager. He got so messed up on drugs. This is the only man in the history of the POA that I've ever forbid to walk back on this campus. He would take ball bats and beat the glasses out of our houses. He was possessed. Remember that day? Yeah, I do too. But God got a hold of him. One church service, he came and said, Pastor, if you'll let me come back to church, something's happening on the inside of me. God filled him with the Holy Ghost. We baptized him in the name. God called him to preach. He is now finishing his church in Farmerville. We're going up there to dedicate it. His life changed. There is a revival happening in the land. Ron Hinkey was in the Air Force. And I came home. I was playing flag football with the guys in our church. And I cut real quick and tore an anterior cruciate in my knee. And Mike Barber, a friend of ours, heard I'd done it and just had it in a cast from some doctor. He said, you got to go see my doctor and Denny's doctor in Freeport, Dr. Bundrick. So I went up there and he did surgery on me and I had it in a cast. And this guy got busted. He'd come to our church, but he got busted with marijuana. He was getting kicked out of the Air Force. And he said, Pastor, you got to come testify that God's done a change in my life. So I get on those crutches and I go into the courtroom and I throw my cast up on that judge's chair and I turn and I looked at him. And I said, Judge, this guy needs to be kicked out of the Air Force. By all of your laws, by everything, he needs to be court-martialed. Everything needs to be done. But Judge, a few weeks ago, he found Jesus Christ. And God did a great work in his life. And his life has been turned around. Judge, will you please? He said, just bust him one strike, leave him in. He got to stay here. He became one of the greatest mentors of souls. God called him. He got elected in Bossier City. He just finished his new church, and I'm going to dedicate that. He just built that new church in Bossier City. He was a dope-smoking Air Force guy when we found him. In your congregation. Listen, I'm going to mess up here. You're going to get so angry with me. Home missionaries, foreign missionaries, you better listen to me. Don't you touch any of our saints unless you talk to us. Let me qualify that. But I'm going to tell you what. When we hear that a home missionary is going somewhere, you're not going to like this. But we ought to be able to look at one of our couples that's a doctor or that's a nurse or that can transfer. And we ought to say, I got a couple I'm going to send with you. I'm going to help you go build that church. That hurts for us to say that. But if we can get kingdom minded and we can start sending people out, not just with daughter works, but helping people reach a lost world. The question is not how many do we have, how many have we sent out? How many preachers have we reproduced? It's time that we quit talking about our children being doctors and lawyers. We got to start doing hard things and start talking about our children being missionaries and being evangelists and being pastors and spreading the gospel of Jesus Christ. And there's nothing wrong with our kids being doctors, because they can take their doctor degree and they can go to Haiti right now and they can help keep people alive. What I'm saying is we've got to turn our children and our churches into mission revival churches and have revival. That is my burden. And I'm sorry that I preached an hour and 5 or 10.
You know why Jesus went to Calvary? Two reasons. First, he was persuaded that his dying would shed blood that was powerful enough to forgive the worst person. You ready? And then he was persuaded that death wasn't powerful enough to hold him. Destroy this temple, and in 3 days, I'm going to raise it back up. You know why we got a church? And I'm persuaded I'll build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. If God is persuaded, why don't you get persuaded? Let's say it again. Ready? The three greatest words in life. Thank you. It's not God is love. It's I am persuaded God loves me. It's not God is able to heal. It's I am persuaded God will heal me. We've had such moves of the Holy Ghost here, and yet somehow God has said to my heart, tell these people the greatest thing they'll get out of this whole conference is to walk out of here with an innate persuasion. I got a word for you. Some of you got prayed for. Some of you got anointed. Some of you got spit all over. Somebody slapped you around and you didn't get your healing. The Lord told me to tell you, tell my people, sometimes my healing comes as a seed. And they want a full harvest. That's a miracle. But miracles are not always given to people. But healing comes as a seed. What does that mean? You better be persuaded the seed can be stolen. You better water it. You better protect it. You better nurture it. You better pray over it. You better bless it. You better encourage it. You better talk to it. You better be persuaded that the miracle is in the seed.